Let's open the meeting at 6:05. Oh, it's not that late.
No.
Can I get a motion to review and to approve the minutes of January 23rd, 2020?
Yes, excellent.
Motion second?
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
All right, minutes are approved. Financial statement.
So there's 9 warrants there for signature totaling $83,286.25. I emailed out the general fund and school choice expenditure reports through January 31st electronically. Happy to take questions if you have them. I also did let you know in my memo that we discovered sped transportation was underfunded in the FY20 general fund. So we're looking to take $24,000 from school choice to cover that. It's an increase that Karen Two-Sided was and wasn't expecting, the special education director. There's been some changes on the bus. The price is higher than she thought it was going to be. And when the numbers were put in for last year's budget process, they were not inclusive of all of the needs. So for next year, for FY21, they are included there properly. So we've made sure that we've captured that. But at this point, that is the only spot to take that money from.
Is that GRIPCO? Does that transportation?
It's part GRIPCO and part JB.
Okay.
That had nothing to do with the previous consultant doing it? That was just sort of a...
So I think there may have been some miscommunication between Karen and my predecessors, the consultants, about what the needs were. I'm not sure that they fully understood the budget process enough to ask the right questions. And so Karen, I think it got dropped a little bit on her end during budget season and didn't come up till quite later. Even over the summer when her and I looked at it, she didn't quite catch it at that point. But now that we've got bills coming in, we're assessing the situation. So fortunately, we do have school choice money. There also is special education revolving money so that if we needed to move some things around towards the end of the year, we could do that as well as an option.
So it doesn't put us in a bad position in any line?
No.
Okay.
The only other comment that I have that came up today, Michelle Melnick, who is our new accounts payable person for the 4 elementary schools, noticed that the town deadline for warrants this month is before our meeting date again. If you remember,
geez.
two months ago, I think we had the issue where I had to ask you guys to come in to sign. We're going to try to set up the same thing with Jan so that she'll allow us to get a warrant in. Otherwise, it's going to be April before our bills get paid again, and we don't want that to happen. So we're looking, the town deadline is the 16th and the school committee meeting is the 19th.
Yep.
So I'm looking to get something in before the 16th. So we'll work out the date that Jan wants us to have on that warrant, and then I'll send out an email, ask you guys to come by and sign.
Okay. And are they going to be at the town hall, or do you think? Or?
What's most convenient for you guys?
Town hall.
Town hall is more convenient?
Well, I can walk to it, so it's convenient for me.
I can make it work.
Okay. Is the town hall convenient for you, Denise?
What time does it open?
Particularly.
Yeah, I think Frontier would be easier for me.
Okay.
But whatever.
Well, we can try for Frontier, and if we don't get three, then I'll let you know, Phil, and we can get it to the town hall for you to sign it.
Here. We have to take care of the needs of our newest members. So they
on
stay.
My way to work.
They stay for a while. They want to get reappointed.
Exactly. When is the caucus?
When is the caucus? That's a good question too.
You don't know.
It's March sometime.
Oh, it's March.
Yeah.
I thought it was the night in February.
You would know.
Okay. All right. Public comment. Do we have any public that would like to comment, or are you just here to listen?
Here, listen, but I just questioned the sped revolving fund, and I'll have to go and educate us how it works. You're putting out a full-time sped teacher from the sped revolving camp. The school, I'd imagine, that through the WINGS program?
Yes, exactly.
And how does that select it? So, I don't know what the projected enrollment is, how many students are from school choice versus kind, but how does that, how do you anticipate the funding for that?
It is tuition-driven, and the program brings in more tuition than we have expenditures, so it's able to absorb that salary. And it will still have a surplus at the end of the year.
So like, how many students next year are you projecting in sped versus what we have currently?
In that program?
Yes. It's a very good program.
We currently have 12. We have 10. Carrying over into next year with two spots open. We typically always fill the spots.
It is a good, I mean, this program's always at capacity.
Any idea what?
It saves our other towns in the district money to send them to us versus an out-of-district placement, which is significantly more expensive.
Yeah, understood. So about the projected enrollment next year, I mean. It's roughly half-half.
So currently, there are 12 students. We already have 10 slots filled for next year, so we'll have two open slots, which we always want a couple open slots for other students. So we expect, we don't have those slots filled yet. There's no reason to believe that we won't.
Is there any kind of a state mandate in terms of number of sped students to full-time faculty? Is it?
Well, part of it is the space. We keep it to 12. A lot of the reason for that is because of the space.
Space constraint. Thank you.
My understanding is the individual plans of each child would have the requirements for the staffing requirements. It's not like a state requirement. It's.
There are state requirements, but
I mean, some, are any kids in there on a one-to-one?
Several.
Several on a one-to-one.
Many of those come from different districts.
But they actually, from observation over time, they do a good job integrating the kids into the general population, which is ultimately the goal. Once you have kids in a substantially separate classroom, it's hard to bring them back into the larger group, but that's actually much better for them to be integrated as much as possible. And they really do a good job of that.
Best public school program I've ever seen for kids.
Anything else?
In case you haven't been introduced, Alan, this is Alan Singer from Conway Finance Committee. I don't know if you've met Shelley yet, who's the new business manager.
We've had some email exchanges.
I found it, we've wanted to.
Everybody else you've met?
The black curtain.
What about it?
And then what is EC involved in?
Early childhood.
Early childhood.
Acted fast. Okay. Unfinished business. Update on capital requests.
Sorry, this wasn't in your packet.
Late to one meeting, asking to miss the next meeting. What is going on with you?
He's had a rough week.
My God, acting out all over the place.
First rule of problems when you're.
You move closer and you're late.
I don't have my bag. How did you get in the car with all your bag? We're going to swim practice.
That's a tough one.
You get it, like, wing it?
Right.
Go with the other shoes?
Remember, Dad, you're on TV. Don't embarrass.
Somebody's daughter I know has happened to.
So this is our list, our sort of wish list, and I think what our hope is for next year, and Tom, I did get some, I do have some estimates, but we'll put an email to you. We're hoping to replace the main hallway carpet, and that estimate, Bill Hildreth emailed me just a little bit ago, $16,000. And then the hydration station in the upper hallway, we have one in the lower hallway. And I have an estimate for $2,300. Now, these are just via emails. I don't actually have the, you know, he looked at the. So those are the two things that we'd be looking for next year. And then we just we'll just continue down on the list as we go along. But
so the top three are the your needs.
Yeah. And so, Tom, if we decided to also do a new classroom floor, that's been averaging around $5,000, so that'd be $21,000 to $24,000. And I'll put that in a email to ASAP. I know the sooner the better for that.
Well, in terms of like process, if we're going to do it, we need to decide to do it. If it's going to be for this year, we need to decide to do it like tonight. No. I mean,
for those three?
Well, no. I mean, some of those things are already on the request. What I saw come out today was different and had numbers attached. What I saw that you had sent around for the grammar school capital request, it had numbers attached to each item.
I think that was for the Frontier.
I sent out Frontiers today too.
I didn't have numbers for Conway. I couldn't have sent them out.
Okay.
I just talked to Tom today.
All right. I guess it was Frontier. Sorry.
I did send them out today, so it makes sense.
When do we need this? This just needs to be ready for the warrant, right?
So I think, Tom, correct me if I'm wrong, if you could get them tomorrow, you'd be happy, right?
Oh, I'd be very happy. I understand that you don't have quotes, actually.
I think Bill does have.
But if I would trust Bill's judgment
okay.
on that.
Okay, so, okay, great.
I would suggest soundproofing the psychologist office. Might want to move up the list.
Move up? It's terrible. It's terrible. So we had
That's a HIPAA violation or a FERPA violation.
Well, the problem is, it's when I came on board, the office door, there's a door leading to the gym.
Yep.
And they had soundproof that. They put soundproof padding with nails through the door. That's how it was when I came. And then when the fire marshal came, he told me, that door needs, I'm not leaving until that door comes down because you've,
you need another exit.
Broken the
fire rating. Rating.
Integrity of
the fire rating.
So we had to take that door down, and he said that will never happen again. I was like, oh, that was here when I got here. I'm sorry, which is true. So we literally had to take that door down and replace it within like 48 hours. But the you can't even have an office there. It's a terrible place. The gym, it's like you're in the gym.
So you probably need a higher quality door.
We got a really high quality door. We paid a lot of money for that door. So, I don't know. It's on the wish list for...
I think it needs to move up the wish list.
You can look into it.
There's no such thing as a fireproof sound? There's no fireproof soundproof? After that Rhode Island nightclub fire, isn't that what they invented?
We got from the experts what we could, the best recommendation that we could possibly have, and we got it. We paid a lot of money for the door. Mm-hmm. Nope. Terrible.
Wow.
We can look into it.
There's also stuff like they have at hair salons and stuff that's like, it looks like, I know you're not cow people, but those things that cows itch themselves on, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, those are nasty.
They're like pieces of rubber with like bumps all over them, and they stick them on things in the middle of fields, and the cows come up and like itch themselves on them. But it looks just like that, only your hairdresser has them on their wall, and they absorb sound. Because, you know, in a hairdresser, everybody's telling all their problems to their hairdresser, chair by chair.
Why would they want that? And it
can be really noisy. So they have these things to like absorb some of the sound from
there. And then you have a lot of staff out there like rubbing their back up against it.
Only the ones that know. Now, I can't imagine they're the same product, but they look the same. So that might be something you could actually attach.
Yeah, we'll look into it. She has a white noise machine the whole night.
Oh, yeah, there's only so many of those you can take. So.
And then, Kristen, the last, I remember talking to you the last time I saw you about the playground.
We're working on the playground grant. We're hoping to have that ready. I have the committee coming in on Tuesday to finish that up. So we're hoping to have it over vacation week. So we're hoping to have that ready to go roll by the end of the day on Tuesday.
Because the CPA committee that has to go before, you're still thinking CPA?
Yeah, that's what we're doing.
Then have you contacted that committee?
we're finishing the application.
Great.
It's lengthy.
Because that...
Which, you know, is understandable.
That timing, that's crunch timing for that as well, because they have to approve it, and then it gets signed. I don't know if there's still, is there still time to do a CPA for this cycle?
Yeah, they're actually meeting Monday night.
That's right.
Should I go?
Yes.
I mean, should I, I don't know if I can go, I mean, could be a hotel.
It's, well, it's not on their agenda at this point, but maybe they have items not anticipated.
But you get,
who's the chair of that?
The one's on the agenda before Thursday, they can do the agenda up until Thursday.
And, Monday's a holiday, so they have it, it was done yesterday.
When do they meet again, Tom?
And today's Thursday.
Yeah.
When do they meet again?
I don't know, I think they may meet as necessary, they may not finish all their, all their business tonight.
The application didn't have a deadline or anything.
No, because their deadlines are sort of set by where, when town meeting is and all that, so.
Who's the chair of that committee now?
Malcolm Kors.
Oh, okay.
So, Tom, if I get, email you tomorrow, will you send me his contact information?
Sure.
Okay. What's the name again, I'm sorry?
Malcolm Kors is the chair.
Thank you.
I thought we replaced the intercom system.
Well, it's really down on the wish list, right? It should be really down.
Yep.
Because ours is terrible.
Didn't we just do that last year?
It's terrible.
Do you remember, Ash? That's a safety issue.
No, it's okay. Like, it's not, it's the qual, I mean, we can get kids out, we can, the quality is really terrible.
Oh, good.
I don't know.
Good thing Ashley's not here.
Yeah, we can, it does what it's supposed to do. So you want a wish list, right? So that
I totally do. Yeah, yeah, but I just also
the quality's
that,
really
that raises
hard
safety concerns.
Some
it's
rooms
not.
It's oh, it's deafening in some rooms, and in some rooms it's it's not a good
I'm
quality.
Sure technology's
system.
Gotten a lot better yeah. from the time that thing was.
I don't
installed.
Know why that one was chosen, or
yeah,
but it's pretty awful.
Okay.
You know, I saw also on this list was. And I don't, with the store, water storage, and or I don't quite know what exact, but I did hear that there were bits and pieces of the old tank that appeared in some new, that interfered with some well, with the well or something like that.
Yeah,
I don't
you
know
quite
what,
Phil,
what
I don't, I'll be honest with you, I don't, as I was typing this, I don't know what that is.
Which one's it?
Water outlet hookup for well water storage tank. Bill had it on the list. And I don't know what it is.
Well,
and since we weren't asking for it this year, I didn't do some heavy research on it. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't on the priority. It wasn't on the
red. The outlet hookup, if this is what he's talking about here, is that they're talking about as you run out of water, you can hook a water tanker up to your water system. We don't have the ability now, so we only get so many gallons per minute. And so if this was ever used as a, and so when it runs down, there's no way to emergency refill it. And if this was ever used as an emergency site and you start going through water faster than you can fill the tank, which is really low for
it's like 5 gallons a minute or something.
Yeah, something really poor. And that's why we've had in the past cancellations of school day when the water ran all night, and the alarm didn't go off. We've since repaired that. But when that happens, because it doesn't fill fast enough. So now they're also talking about you can, you know, basically put a hook up, or you can get a water tanker, fresh water, hook it up in case of emergency. However, they ran into some issues regarding that the way it was, and so they put it off. They were going to do it this year, and then they put it off. So I don't know the issues that they ran into, but that's what they're talking about fixing. So,
the one-way film for preschool windows?
So that's something Jim Carmichael has been wanting us to get.
That's pretty cheap.
For a long time, it's actually not as cheap as you thought it was, but the, you think it is, but...
How cheap did you think it was?
Well, because we did it on all our clinic windows.
And maybe it's what particularly Jim wants, but you know what the issue with that is that we have it on here because I completely respect Jim Carmichael's, you know, Whately School... It so regrets putting it's it makes the room really dark and so it's not top on our list because we want to do more research as to what else might come up down the pike
because we have film on our front office windows in the clinics.
Yep.
And you can see through it, but it's got like designs on it, so you can't, you couldn't like, you know, see through it clearly.
Yeah, yeah.
And then at one point we put stuff that is more like mirror image. That yes. That stuff is dark.
Yeah.
You know, that yeah. That starts blocking natural right. light. So we went to this other design one where the light still comes through.
I know Jim Carmichael would be thrilled if that.
Yeah, you don't want to keep your natural light out.
If we put it on the warrant, though, because he's every time he comes for a drill, he says, "We got to take care of those preschool windows because you know where they're all. It's all windows all around."
Mm-hmm.
I will just have to teach the parents just to pretend you see your kids because it's a huge tradition when they drop their kids off. They wait. The kids go running to the windows and they wave to their kids.
That would be a big loss.
But
actually.
Safety first.
It's also the whole. It sets the when you walk in and you just see that joy and laughter and playing and all that. It sets the whole mood and the energy for the building as you walk in. And I would hate to lose that. Like these types of security things, I always wonder, is there data that shows that this particular thing works or has saved lives or has worked in the past? If there isn't, then don't do it just because you like the guy that makes the suggestion.
No, right? It's like, not that I like the guy. Jim Carmichael knows what he's doing.
I know.
I mean, he's the best, and mm-hmm. he's the best with school safety.
Mm-hmm.
Hands down, bar none.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't ask for a lot. Mm-hmm. You know, he asks for what he really thinks we need, and he really believes that we need.
Mm-hmm.
Because he said that if someone got, you know, if we had a shooter, there's all those little kids with wide open, you know, window.
Yeah.
So maybe I didn't say it the way I should.
No, I mean, I get it. You cannot bulletproof your school. I don't know where that stuff ends. I don't know. It's the distant future. We'll deal with it then.
Well, you could do something in a compromise so you can't see as clearly, but you can still see
through. Yeah,
so,
yeah.
But. Anyway, I don't know if that would satisfy him or not, but okay. I think the regrinding and replacing parking lot and whatever should be a town issue.
You do? You think that, huh?
I think that. Tom, Bill, that should be a town issue.
Well, the school is a town issue every year. The school is the town.
I think the driveway and the parking lot should be on the town's bill.
I
have a question. Is a long-term capital planning committee coordinating with the Conway Grammar School in terms of funding of projects and at this point, the Conway Grammar Capital Stabilization Fund, there's like no metric to figure out if it's well capitalized or not.
It is well capitalized because they've been planning on it and adding to it.
Everything is relative, but I mean, as the advocate, devil's advocate, I say, well, you think it does, but until you go through and do a physical inventory of what these costs are, and get, I guess the goal of the long-term capital improvements committee is to get every building that the town is responsible for to get on a maintenance plan, right?
The school has been exempted from that in our current policy because the school was doing its own capital planning. It has its own stabilization fund and is managing that. But if we need a better delineation of where the line is, then it sounds like we do.
I can say that the way that this... I was on the committee like 8-9 years ago when the thing was set up. And the way that the thinking was that we wanted to worst case scenario with the building, and the worst case scenario was the simultaneous loss of both boilers, and something else happening with the roof or another major system, and we added up like maximum potential costs. Realistically,
for the biggest ticket items,
so that they can just be fixed, and you don't have to close school waiting for a town meeting, and things like that. So that and that was, and when that we just totaled up that number, and that's what we.
I think it was $275,000 or $325,000.
Something we were putting away $50 a year. I think.
Yeah, we had money last year because we decided that was.
Last year we decided that we were at our number.
Yeah.
But that's not really a capital planning number. That's more of a general stabilization emergency, almost a reserve fund for emergencies.
Right.
So I think there is still room for a capital plan that shows all of these capital items that need to be replaced.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And again, the town... could conceivably take that on, but they haven't at this point because the town understood that it was the school's project, the school's stabilization fund, and your priorities, and there didn't seem to be any reason to get involved at that point. But that, yeah, that is not really a capital plan. That's more of an emergency reserve fund, general stabilization plan.
Darius, do any of the other three schools in the Frontier system have any kind of a, for the respective learning schools or anything?
They all do, including Conway. So we have a general maintenance capital plan, but we don't have the next roof. You know what I mean? The next, you know what I mean? Like those, I mean, you can get really, so we look at 3 to 5 out about what we see coming down the, I was just gonna log in and pull that up, because that's where a lot of this list came off of.
Yeah. Right? There's a certain level where something like a roof becomes a borrowing question, and that should be part of a capital plan,
right?
But it's not necessarily part of funding a capital stabilization
account. Right, and that's what I'm saying is that in our capital planning, we've done 3 to 5 out, not looking at like the major kind of things, but the carpet, you know, those kind of, the turning over the bathroom stalls, fixtures, those kind of things. Smaller items, those are on the list. I'm going to try to pull it up here.
All the fun stuff of running a school, huh?
Right, well, but the you know, it's a good question. Conway is, so I basically have a, you know, looking over the capital projects a lot, it's very similar to this list. It's talking about the AC, it's talking about yearly flooring upgrades. There's miscellaneous painting.
How many offices have air conditioning? Just the library?
Main office, library, wings. That's it.
We better get on that one.
Yes. Mm. Teachers are hearing about this. They're all excited.
Right, and even it has some of the kitchen equipment in there from, you know, the kitchen hood upgrade, those kind of things. They aren't broken yet, but it's in a kind of our thing, and those are, you know, it's a, like a $40,000 kind of thing.
Oh my God, really?
Hood upgrades and kitchen equipment, so mixed together. So, I mean, these are numbers that I'm reading. I don't, they were given to me, so I can't verify that they were, they're from Bob originally.
I think I took the things off of that last time.
Yeah. And then in there is also the playground stuff. So, you know, right now Conway's in the best shape out of all the schools in the sense of its capital list is not as dire. You've done a good job of maintaining and keeping ahead of a lot of things. A lot of things aren't just not falling apart right now. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, thank you. Knock on wood. Yeah. That's why it hasn't kind of been a priority in the sense that other schools are doing. We're talking about capital, you know, heavy stuff, and then looking 3 years out because they can't afford to do what they have to do in the first year, in the second year. Mm-hmm. The question that's different for Conway is that because they've created their own capital stabilization account, the question is, it's been explained to me, but we're going to the town to borrow our own capitalization account, and then the town's going to refill that account in the same year.
It's a separate warrant.
Why don't you just put that aside and go straight to the town for a capital warrant item and hold that money on the side for emergencies. So it's kind of like you're pulling from an account. So, you know, I mean, it seems like, and it took me a while, that kind of, not a while, but it took me, I didn't quite first understand it, because the other towns, I go straight with a warrant through the capital committee of the town that says, this is what we need this year and this is what we're projecting for next year. You know, we're going to need, let's say right now we're looking at probably $25,000 for this year. You know, next year, if we're talking about doing the driveway, it is all the same money.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, in the next 2 or 3 years, you know, if we want to do the driveway, then the capital committee would say to us, well, you know, maybe then we're going to hold next year. You're getting nothing next year because we're going to give you the $150,000 to do the whole driveway the following year. And that's kind of how it is. Meanwhile, you have the stabilization fund for breakage, you know what I mean, for system failures that have to be done that year. So I don't know. I mean, we can, you know, I mean, it's got to come from the town.
My thought would be that the capital stabilization fund could be, I mean, if you want to go, the town is ultimately responsible for this school, so it could be maybe a buffer so you don't have a big budget item increase for capital improvements in the town in 1 year that might result in, you know, a fairly sizable property tax rate increase that might incur the wrath of the community.
Well, I mean, in general, things like paving projects are absolute budget busters for schools.
Yeah, sure, of course.
Just even little small things are hundreds of thousands of dollars, and, yeah, so.
But the nice part about the capitalization, so let's say you're gonna paint the library. Well, you know, while it seems like it's a small price thing, it really isn't in your maintenance budget. So how do you get that, really gonna put painting on a warrant of the library, and then you're gonna have that discussion, does the library really need painting? Or, you know, it's just one coat of paint in one room, you know, can we be trusted with that money? And that's where sometimes that stabilization, there's an advantage to that.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, the way you're doing the stabilization is you're doing it the same way you do a warrant.
Right.
You know what I mean? So,
well, to be fair, the town side of the capital stabilization is not sufficiently funded either. We have a committee, finally, that's working on a good long-term plan, and all the plan has been for in the past has been vehicles. We haven't even included our buildings in it, let alone bridges, which are, you want to talk about budget busters, that's where they're. And again, there you're talking about projected borrowing rather than saving up money for it. So that's the town has some ground to make up on its own, and I can only urge, you know, more of this kind of capital planning over the next 3 to 5 years, and figuring out what you need for that, and then funding either it's the same account, or, you know, with the understanding that some of it's reserved for emergencies, or a separate account. The town has both a general stabilization account and a capital stabilization account. So the general has been more for emergencies. It hasn't been well defined, so that's the way I've been thinking of it, but I've also used it to supplement the capital stabilization when that seemed like a good thing to do as well. So it's a choice of how you want to approach it. So there's the emergency, and then so that what's now the capital stabilization fund is really the general stabilization,
right.
And we need to start putting money in for the regular replacements of and you know, defining capital in Conway, is it 5,000 over 5 years is the capital.
And Frontier has a policy has all those policy definitions too. I think that was the number in the Frontier policy definition for capital as well. So I mean, the thing that makes sense is there are certain things that it makes sense, like asphalt, like doing the. To me, it makes sense to sort of work in closer coordination with the town than in some other things, like carpeting of the hallway or whatever.
Yeah.
Just because I don't know much about asphalt, I do know that there are efficiencies of scales or like volume discounts, and that it would make sense to work with the road boss to the extent of like where what else is getting paved.
And that's exactly what's happening in Waitley. So Waitley is due to have their driveway in and parking lot repaved, and so we're already talking with George. I mean, the road's in the road, and talking about, okay, if it's what year is this going to go on, and does it going to fit with another project, and how the best kind of approach it. So, but knowing a couple of years out and doing things like that,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, to exactly do exactly
what you're saying. My thought would be, you know, make the policy about a certain dollar cutoff amount below which, that's the purview of the school to do that and make it down more.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, good idea.
So the other thing is on the timing of it, do you need to vote, because you need a two-thirds vote to put it on the warrant to spend the money, when do they need that vote by? Because all the other...
To get it on the warrant?
I mean, you have the latest meeting, so you probably have a little bit more time.
If the next meeting isn't until when?
March 19th.
March 16th.
You're still good, right? Because then you...
Oh, our meeting is the 19th.
Mm-hmm.
March 19th here.
Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
When are the warrants being prepared? I mean, you guys are until May, right? For
well, I come out with a preliminary budget the end of February, latest beginning of March. So I need preliminary figures at least by then. And then, because I need to balance the budget before I present it, and then I present that. So I'm waiting for your budget to put, you know, my budget out. And I would like to do that in certainly the next couple of weeks. In terms of actual numbers and final figures, and, you know, I can stick placeholders in the warrant. That's not a problem. But we need those. The select board is slated to sign the warrant a month before the town meeting. So that would be the second Monday in April.
Okay.
And because we need time to get it printed and mailed, and people like to have it 2 weeks before the town meeting, so that's, we back up from that.
So your placeholder right now is just under 25,000. With a 10%.
I have 19.3.
I get, we'll put a 10% on that and round it everything up. My glasses. So, but we'll get you the numbers.
We're dealing with some small margins here, so that you know, there's a big difference. There's not a big difference, but there is a difference between 19.3 and 25. So right now I'm hearing, actually that would be 18.3.
$16,000 for the hallway.
And $2,300 for the hydration station.
And then the flooring upgrades, if we go ahead with one classroom, that's $5,000 to $6,000.
Well, now we're talking over 30,000.
Right,
yep.
No, I had 16 plus 5 is 21, plus 2,300 is 24, and that's why we're 23, whatever, and that's why I rounded up to 25.
Yeah. And we're talking 24,000 for the flooring upgrades and 16,000 for the carpet.
No, 16,000.
That's 20,000, that's 30,000 right there.
16,000 for the hallway.
I'm sorry?
16,000 for the hallway.
5,000 for the hallway? Oh, where did I hear 21 to 24,000?
Total.
That was total.
Thank you.
If I do 16 for the main carpet, the classroom upgrade for 5 to 6,000, and 2,300 for the hydration station was just under 25,000, and I just kind of rounded up the placeholder until Christy gave you the numbers. But Kristen's, she can get you numbers either way, so we might be having a conversation for no real reason, because she's going to get those in the next couple of days, because they're not hard numbers to get.
That's good. The one caveat I'll just mention right now is we might. Typically, when we take things from stabilization, which is where the town really has its say on yay or nay, we like to try to refill it, and we would probably have trouble refilling the account to this amount this year. It would introduce competition between projects right now. If it's coming from free cash, and you know, we're trying not to raise and appropriate what's not in the operating budget, so that's just one consideration, and a really good reason to get the requests in capital requests in by say end of December.
Further discussion on the FY21 budget.
Okay. So you have a summary narrative page, you have the line by line page, and then a school choice summary analysis as well.
Yep.
So I'm going to go through the narrative. Just a comment that the line by line change is the budget FY21 compared to the budget FY20. So some of the numbers, you can't just look at them and say, oh, well, this isn't on here, because it's not comparing the same thing. So I just want to make sure everybody understands that. So our first draft came in at 3.89% the first time we met, and we are at 2.46% at this point. I do want to mention that we didn't cut anything necessarily. We really just kind of moved funding sources around, because that initial draft of the budget included that new special education teacher being on the general fund. So I've kind of moved some funding. I'm going to go through the additions. I think Darius brought up a good point at Frontier that I just also wanted to share here, that while there may be a reduction or an increase in general repair for X, there might also be an increase in another general repair line, and ultimately they net and offset each other, but trying to be as transparent as possible and show you where all of the changes are. So stop me if you have questions, or ask at the end. So we are looking at a 2.46% increase, or $48,089, for a total town appropriation of $2,367. The following expenditures that I'm going to go over were either added to the budget or they were increased over FY20. teacher salaries and IA salaries, I want to let you know that this number that's here is not necessarily a direct hit to the general fund, but did want to share the percentage increases. Teachers and IAs are funded from other funding sources, so it doesn't all fall to the local budget. But the increase based on a potential contract settlement is $37,000 or 2.91%. And that includes column movement, step movement, as well as a cost of living adjustment built in for a potential contract settlement. IAs are looking at approximately $16,000 or 3.83% based on their contract. Those are wage increases. We are moving ahead, hopefully, with new copiers for the offices and the teachers' use, and that is an addition of $4,000 for a new lease. Teacher mentor stipends of $2,500 was an addition to the budget. These were previously funded from a grant. We have found out that we will be getting that grant again. I don't remember if Conway's numbers are up or down.
Every grant numbers?
Yeah. We do know we're getting it, but this is a recurring expense that we would like to get on the local budget versus relying on that grant funding, because we don't know year to year, and sometimes we don't know before the budget is created if we're going to have that money. So we want to make sure that we're adding that back in. We added $1,500 for curriculum planning needs for stipends to be paid to teachers for curriculum development. We increased general classroom supplies by $2,000 based on the needs of the school. We added $1,000 for any potential costs associated with the keyless entry system, which is the new key fob system for the building. While it's brand new, you never know what can happen when things break. Want to have some funds available for that if needed. We increased custodial support to allow for additional summer help by $3,600. Building repairs, this line has seemed to go over for the past 3 years, so I adjusted that based on actuals, increased by $7,000 to general repairs. Same thing with our testing, which is for the like the smoke detectors, the fire alarm, the fire extinguishers. That had also been over expended in the last 3 years, so I increased that based on actuals by $2,000. And there is a wage increase built in here of $4,750 for any non-union personnel. That includes anyone in central office, Conway's portion of that, principals, secretaries, custodians, et cetera. Anyone who's not in a collective bargaining unit. Any questions on that?
Is that, what's the percentage increase of the wage? Is it 2 or 3?
There is a 2% built in right now. Any other questions before I move on?
Okay. So just the field trip, it increased by 509. That's an unusually specific number.
Yeah, I rounded. For some reason, last year's budget had a lot of uneven numbers in it, like 994.
Yeah.
So I rounded things. So there are a few lines that happens. Mm-hmm. The 500 was an increase request by the principal
good.
For field trips.
Yeah. Good.
Okay, so to allow for all of those additions that we just talked about and for the salary increases, we obviously had to adjust down some of our lines. Mm-hmm. So we have moved an IA to the EC revolving fund. This puts an additional IA on that. It is someone who works in the program. That program is tuition driven. They do have the money to support it, and they will have a healthy balance based on the current enrollment projections at the end of next year still. We had a decrease of almost $4,000 in the nursing line. There was a change in staffing because the nurse that was here full-time, and please correct me if I'm getting this wrong because this happened sort of right when I first started, she's now part-time at Conway because she's the nurse leader for the district. And so hiring her replacement allowed us to see some savings. So there's some savings actually in FY20, but we're really seeing them in FY21. Assuming that that's built the same way next year.
I remember when she was on the school committee going to nursing school.
Me too.
And then we do not have any anticipated retirement payouts for FY21, so that would be reduced by almost $13,000 to the budget. That's a line that is questionable year to year, as we've talked about. We're never quite sure who's going to retire or what that sick buyback will be. So it's a little bit of a risk to take it out. And then the following year, we could potentially be adding it back in. But again, we have to reduce somewhere to try to cover the increases.
How many teachers are close in the building?
I don't know that off the top of my head. Do you know anybody?
I don't know. I don't really ask people when they retire, so I don't know.
Yep.
Because I don't want anyone to retire.
Yeah. Right.
I don't want to put that in their heads.
Yeah.
I mean, Conway certainly has one of the more veteran staff mm-hmm. lists comprehensively over everybody else, but that doesn't necessarily mean that
right. Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sped transportation. So we talked to this about this in relation to FY20. So same issue, but we're getting it in here this time, which is good. So we have a total increase of $27,500 to the sped transportation. That brings that line item up to $41,000 needed for special ed transportation next year. We are going to increase the general fund line item by just under $7,000 and fund the rest through school choice. That full-time sped teacher that we talked about in the first draft, after reviewing the budget that the special education director has put together, which is based on the FY20 budget that the teacher had put together, and looking at the revolving funds, this revenue source can definitely handle the weight of an additional teacher mm-hmm. And will still have some surplus rolling over into the revolving account mm-hmm. after that. So that's one of the biggest changes of how we brought that 3.8 down, because, you know, 55,000 in itself is a significant increase. So happy to take other questions.
So the one thing that's not on our budget, thank goodness, because it exceeds the amount of increase from last year to this year, is the health insurance issue with the town planning for two additional enrollees in the health insurance and getting six mm-hmm. and the price tag for that was close to like $50,000. That was sort of an unanticipated hit. It doesn't come out of our budget, it goes to the town budget because it's the health, but it was still a big so do you know anything about how we got without adding like new, we didn't add new employees, we just added new participants in our insurance program more so than could reasonably be anticipated.
I know a lot of employers are going to programs that don't cover spouses. So if somebody's employer no longer covered their spouse, they would have had to jump on ours. It would be one example of how that might happen.
Any IA changes? We didn't add positions, but if an IA left and we got a new one, maybe the previous one didn't take the insurance and the new one did. Mm. I mean, I could certainly look into it more.
Yeah, and I don't have privy to that information. Who's on our health insurance or not?
No, but I could definitely.
So that was. I know our the yeah. town's Jan Warner, who has been sort of the person yeah. that deals with this yeah. on behalf of the yeah. town. That it was a real surprise to just because. The two was always a reasonable number to like budget forecast in, and over like decades that had always been a reasonable number,
yeah,
and then all of a sudden it went to six.
Yeah, I want to make sure Jan knows that we didn't hire six.
Well, she knows that because yeah. like that, yeah. but it was just, and so like from her perspective, like in terms of you want predictability, you want like to be able to forecast.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so that's the big thing. It's like they had it like more knowledge.
I think the forecast is really looking at who's not on our health insurance, right?
We'll provide a health insurance update to you.
Okay.
I mean, we're not going to be able to tell you exactly
who?
Being
yeah.
the number,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
but we'll be able to say in general, yeah. you know, the number of previously employed or new employed versus you can kind of get the number that way. So mm-hmm. you just have an idea of what's going on there. And then out of the total, who are currently on and who are not.
Yeah.
And so we can at least, I know you wear two hats, so you can have that the town yeah. hat of mm-hmm. at least see any projected differences there.
Okay.
So if there's no additional questions about the general fund mm-hmm. Or feedback on that, I want to talk a little bit about school choice. So I do need to add in that $24,000 on the transportation that I talked about. So that's going to change the numbers a little bit here. Just to explain it, the balance coming into FY20 was $274,000. Our receiving revenue for FY20 was $231,000. So we went into this year with $506,000 in revenue. We had planned for expenditures of $240,000 plus that $24,000 for the special ed. So we're looking at $264,000. So our balance going into FY21 would be $241,000. Mm-hmm. These numbers, again, are a little bit different than yours because I need to add that transportation in. Right now, the cherry sheets as they exist, revenue for FY21 coming in would be $251,000. So we'd be looking at a total of $492,000 going into FY21, which is down $13,000 from where we were this year. Not a huge decrease, but certainly worth noting. And then we're looking at expenditures of $277,000 out of school choice for FY21, which is about $12,500 over FY20. And looking at ending the end of year, the $239,000 that's on your sheet, less the $24,000 that I'll add in there, so $215,000 rolling into FY22. So we're certainly chipping away slowly at our surplus over 2 years, and we want to make sure that we're monitoring that and going into FY21, looking closely to see if there's, or 22, I'm sorry, to see if there's any movement that we can make. You know, that sped transportation number is one of the big increases for next year. So can we fund that from another source once we get through the FY21 year? See if we can move some things around, but you still have a healthy balance with $215,000. I think the goal at most schools is $50,000.
Right.
So, you know, you're still in a really good place. Yeah. And your other two revolving accounts, early childhood and special education, are also in really healthy conditions. So I'm not overly concerned at this point, but obviously, you know, you guys have input on where you'd like the numbers to go. And would love your feedback on whether or not this draft is what we would like to present, or if you want to make some movement.
Yeah.
Anything under three, I mean, is good.
It's a good budget. Good budget, as far as I can tell. As long as you think the needs of the school are being met, you're not scrimping, you're not, I mean... I always ask the question when we were interviewing superintendents, you know, I would ask them to imagine, didn't get to do it with Darius, though, but you were in the room when I interviewed all the other superintendents.
I knew the question was coming.
Yeah. And just imagine yourself on a continuum. What's the most important thing to you when you're putting together your budget? The one side of the continuum is, you know, the faculty lounge, and the other side of the continuum is town hall. You know, where are you on that continuum, like, in terms of, like, meeting the needs of the school versus meeting the needs of the town? And that's, I always just want you to be asking yourself that, to see you're not, like, too far camped on one side or the other. So that's...
I mean, I think this budget, the adding of a special ed teacher, I mean, it's a big ask.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It happens to be a good year for the ask.
Right.
Well, in the sense of everything else is kind of stable, even though the majority of that's coming out of... sped revolving. I mean, I think the goal, if that sped revolving wasn't so healthy, we would probably be adding a little bit to the budget, and you'd probably be looking at a number closer to three. But we were able to do it out of there, and probably next year, we're going to probably add a little bit of that into the local budget to kind of just slowly, you know, it can't be on there for forever, unless, depending on tuitions, it could be on there for a longer period of time. But we'll play those numbers out. But it's a good year to get that position, and Chris and I have had long conversations regarding the importance of that position, how there's been changes, even though there hasn't been large numbers of students changing, the needs of the students are changing, and be able to meet them at the high quality you're talking about. So to answer your question, I would say we are balancing both. And that's why I think you see that in here. We're asking for a significant change, but we're also coming in with a number that's under 2.5, which is, you know...
In that case, it is a thoroughly beautiful budget in all respects.
One sped teacher versus... one out of district placement for year after year after year is a very good investment.
That's correct.
Because And then once you have one kid go out of district, then they start following. So it's a very wise investment. And it's better for kids to be educated in their own community.
Yeah.
So it's a win-win.
Thank you.
Good job, Colin. So we're going, based on years' experience going to town meetings, maybe the percentage increase proposed in a budget due to negotiated contracts, because that's one of the questions I was asked by the town several years ago, then the projected student enrollment for next year and what the average cost is per student, that's another question. That's a standard one. And then the DESE funding formula from this current gubernatorial administration. This budget is reflected with the new DESE funding formula, right?
Except it didn't benefit us.
Yeah, the Student Opportunity Act didn't really.
Okay.
We didn't get a whole, you look at your Chapter 70 funding, you're not gonna see much change there.
So I think it's important to share that with the town meeting, too.
There is one part, and I did, there was one part of the thing.
Phil's been waiting for that for years.
No, there's one part of the act that is flying under the radar that is gonna benefit us, sort of, and that's a change to the EQB method of calculating the minimum contribution of the town to the budget. Which part of it, see, I had to learn all this stuff. And part of it was, people always want to wonder why, for instance, this year in Frontier's budget, Whately's population drops, but their assessment goes up. It's wide. So this EQV, which measures the minimum, and it has to do with the total town income. And it's this complicated algorithm, this ratio.
Can they take out the top and the bottom?
But what they did, they did make a tiny percentage, which is the exact thing that I did go and testify about. Instead of 58% of property, they reduced by a fraction of 1% the amount of income of the town's aggregate gross income of its residents as the factor to calculate the budget. And they put more of it onto property tax itself and less onto income. So that should, that will smooth out the budget a little bit. And we shouldn't have the swings like last year, this year, 12, Frontier, 12 to 2.
That's what it is. It's 12 to 2.
Right.
So,
and so it should. So the swings in the future shouldn't be as rough because those swings are so much based on the town's income. So,
if anyone has any remembrance of why there's income in that formula at all, when there's no way for the town to access it. The EQV shows the actual value of the property, which is, I think, a very good reflection of the town's wealth. But I get that it's probably in there for some similar reason that, yes. The town's wealthy, but the town has no way of accessing income. Unless, somebody wants to propose a municipal income tax. But failing that, it's I think, more distorting than not. And EQV really should be the
measure. See, and this is actually
the measure.
That was the argument against adding the income in the beginning. It got added just because DESE was the proponent of it being added at the time. And because it was another thing that showed the town's ability to pay. But that reasoning only, if a town is 10,000 people in the aggregate, that makes little, when you have small towns that a few families can come and move in and skew it so badly, that doesn't reflect on the town at all, but the numbers show that that argument after, I don't know, I think it's been 15 years since they added income to it, but that argument finally found a sympathetic ear to a tiny fraction of a percent this year. But
it's based on the median, not the mean, because there could be some outliers that skew it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Alrighty. Any other discussion on our budget? We don't have a vote on it tonight.
You vote a preliminary number.
You want to vote, this is the, your tentative budget to bring forward to...
We can pass it out.
So that they know that they're running on a number that you're not going to change on them without... But you then will have a public hearing at the next meeting.
Yep.
Yeah.
Which will vote the official budget moving forward, but they really need a tentative number to run off of.
So moved.
Is our number...
The number is...
2676054?
No, you're voting on the...
The, on the front page, the...
On the general fund, right? That's what we did with Frontier.
The total operating budget, or the...
When they vote at the end, it's going to be the total operating budget. Right now, it's a tentative budget, so the numbers that were...
Are we voting the general fund number or the total operating budget number?
We just need something for the minutes, is what they're saying. So the vote is not, you're not voting the budget. You're voting a tentative budget so that they know when they go back to their committees, they said this is the budget they're moving forward. It's kind of a, you could all...
So you want the town appropriation number?
It's a placeholder, you know, it's not...
Do you want the town appropriation?
If they come back and say they need it lower, then they're going to...
A placeholder based on fact.
Can I get a motion for the FY21 budget draft for $2,367?
Is that the number that we're using?
That's the general fund number that would be for the town.
Then, yes, of course.
And you could, I mean, you could add in the total operating budget number as well if you wanted.
Motion? Yes?
Yes, yes.
Second?
Yes, yes.
All in favor?
Yes.
Aye, okay. There's your preliminary budget.
I just want to make sure that it says...
Yes.
Thank you for the questions, good discussion.
A clean copy of...
Take the whole packet, then.
Yeah.
They're not here, it's fine.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Is there a Conway meeting before they walk out? Is there a Conway meeting where they're going to have a...
Finance committee.
Is there a finance committee?
They usually come here.
Tom, do you have the date on when the finance committee meeting is for the school committee?
Supposed to be this coming Tuesday.
That's not a good plan since it's school vacation week.
It's not my, I haven't been invited.
February 18th, that's what it says.
Darius.
That's preliminary, by the way.
Well, we haven't been invited yet.
So that's the select board meeting?
Yeah, joining the select boards, that's February 18th, that's for the preliminary budgets for both regional and Conway Grammar.
Okay, well, let us know if you want us to do a...
Are we talking about the same thing as...
Yeah, that's preliminary. I wasn't expecting the school committee to attend on Tuesday, but you could if you wanted.
No, that was the only question, is that some years they've had us come to talk about it, and there's some years you haven't. And so right now, you have until, because Frontier's going to be going early, because Frontier has the longest obligation time period before the first town meeting, so they're going to vote their official budget on Tuesday the 3rd. Is there a public hearing on the budget? So I'm just kind of giving you the timeline. If there was a reason, I mean, the both budgets going to Conway this year are reasonable, so to speak.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think they're well within the normal wheelhouse, so I don't know, there shouldn't be a lot of excitement around it, but if you need me, I guess let me know.
And Conway's final budget would be when?
Their public hearing on the budget will be...
March 19th.
March 19th.
Yeah, so we want to have it before then. So we'll use the tentative budget for Conway and the final budget for Frontier, probably.
Yep. Okay.
I think it would be scheduled for March 4th. On Monday, it was March 14th or 15th.
Okay.
15th to Sunday.
16th and Monday.
The 16th to the Monday.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.
New business. Union 38 teachers 1-year settlement agreement.
All right. So... you do have the ability to go to executive session to talk about this. We haven't had to go there in the other meetings. I just kind of give an overview.
Sure.
Although I think your meeting happened after...
The vote was the next night.
But they were going to vote the tentative budget.
Tentative agreement.
The one-year agreement. So anyways, the one-year agreement was accepted by the teachers. And as you know, the basically what happened at the last mediation is the teachers proposed a kind of a whole different change of looking at the salary columns.
Yeah.
And we, I'd say we, but the school side said there's a lot of work. It's going to take months to figure this out in order to project forward the total costs. Perhaps we should look at a one-year settlement and then kind of come back with bringing down some of the tension that was in the air and such. And so we proposed a one-year contract, which was 1% from steps 3 to 13 and 2% for steps 14 and 20. And they accepted that contract for 1 year, and we're going right back into negotiations post-haste. So, so it hasn't given us any less work. It's just kind of moved things along. So,
as you said, it decreased the tension.
It decreased the tension and kind of says, okay, let's take a look at this new approach, or a new idea, and then see if we can, both sides can work on that. So,
and it was 96% of the...
Like, I don't know anything about that officially. I was told it was that it was around 96% voted affirming that, but that's... what I heard through the grapevine. So, anyway, that's what I need tonight, is the voting of the 1 year budget. I mean, 1 year tentative agreement. I mean, not tentative agreement, 1 year contract. Gosh. I was up at 4:20 this morning.
Yeah. Oh, I bet. I bet.
And I didn't have power.
I'm looking at your voice. I'm like, is he really?
No proof.
I did it by candlelight. I didn't have power.
Oh,
power. I take my phone out.
Yeah, it was home night. Did you stay down here yesterday?
I did go home.
Those kind of storms aren't the ones you can call the night before, because it could be nothing, you know, or could have been rain.
Everybody wanted a snow day.
Yeah. How was the decision made? I don't know how this works.
So what I do is I light a bunch of candles. I take a grain of salt and I sit in the middle. I talked to other superintendents where all this texting. I don't know how they used to do it before texting, but there's all these text groups and finding out what everybody's thinking and doing. And then... did I just kick that down? Mm-hmm. Look at my feet.
Yep.
And then I talk to all the road bosses.
Okay.
We go back and forth sometimes, and then I take that in the weather forecast, and then I flip a coin and I make a phone call.
Conway, usually, can you get through the Poland gap or not? Do we see?
Yeah, I mean, many times. Many times the Conway is the one that you're waiting most to hear about, but that's usually how it's done. And so it's best guess at some points, you know.
I remember once Marty called school off, you know, and it was bad in Conway. But then I got down the hill, and it's rainstorm, nothing. And the people down there must have been like, what the heck was she thinking? But up here, it was like a winter wonderland.
We've had multiple storms in the last... two weeks where it changes over to rain, and the question is what time?
Right.
7, 8, 9, and 10 is actually obviously bad. If it's, it's still going there. And so depending on, you know, for example, this morning at 7 a.m. I was down on the main roads and they were all black. I'm in Deerfield now and they were all blacktop.
Yeah.
So it's like, but is it still snowing in, you know, so.
Yeah.
It's weird because all the people that are working at UMass and other towns, it's just rain. They don't have any snow.
No.
Yeah. It's like a winter wonder.
Yeah. Totally, it is.
I can't believe it.
I know.
Yep. All right, so can we get a vote?
Yeah, motion to approve the settlement agreement, 1 year settlement agreement.
All right, second?
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Good to go. And next,
see you next year on that.
Hopefully see you in a few weeks.
Yeah. Less than a few months.
Yeah. Now, all these policies, JBB, JB, JFABD, JFABE, AJF, they're all for us to review, right?
So thanks for the reading of that.
Yep.
And then you'll be voting on it next time. So MASC, you're like, why did I get all these right now? MASC sent us out almost 30 changes to... If you go to MASC's website, our policy manual is on there. And so basically they provide us a service. They give us updates on when the law changes and that kind of thing. And just kind of a quick overview of these. They'll save you from having to read them into every detail. But basically the educational equity and the equal educational opportunities policy is basically making sure that all students have access to all things are offering in the schools. Okay, and all students can enroll in the schools and enroll in the activities of the schools. And so that you're making it, basically pledging to make sure that you stay on, to make sure you're not doing anything that is exclusionary of any of those, of any students in any school. The homeless students enrollment rights and services, the educational opportunities for military children, and the educational opportunities for children in foster care. Again, the themes are very much similar in those new policies as well. Some of them are just rewording of the ones we already have, but basically it's saying you're not going to punish students who have life circumstances based on being foster children, military children, and homelessness in your school. You know, so if a student becomes homeless in your community, you're going to do your best to keep them in the school they're in, and that may cost the district money, but, you know, transportation, that kind of thing. Same thing with military. If you had a military, not so much as much with elementary, but if you're in the secondary, transfer in, and all of a sudden it's like, you know, you need another year and a half to graduate, and they're a senior coming in, but they got transferred from Fort Knox, Kentucky, and now they're here, and they're like, what do you, you know, now they're saying you really need to work with the student to try to get them out there with their peers and not penalize them for something that wasn't their control.
What do you do if a kid's in foster care or in their home in Deerfield, say, and then they get put in a foster home in Springfield?
So this new policy is going to say we will transport them back to their main school.
Districts like to say, nope, not our problem anymore.
So they're trying to do more to stop that because there's nothing more traumatic than changing home and changing school. I think there's rules within there about when they're going to, you know, if you got from here and you're in Boston, they're not going to do.
We're going to get sent these electronically.
You should have got these electronically. Yeah. No, these weren't sent out as part of the packet.
So we read them all and then we vote the next meeting.
And if you have questions, shoot them to me and I can bring them to the next meeting. But
there's
they
are an email, right?
These were all part of the email packet. Donna, if you didn't get it, yell at Donna. Okay. No, yell at me and I'll speak with her.
It's attached to it.
It is, yeah.
It is.
There's actually a whole bunch of other policy questions and suggestions that we have from, that I've received to the school from the Conway Personnel Committee. I didn't forward them to you because I was going to, I thought at some point the policy committee would meet again and that would be the place for them to be dealt with. But for those that don't know, the Conway Personnel Committee attempted to assert jurisdiction over all school personnel and policy issues over the summer or whenever that was. Mm-hmm. And when I found out, I got Darius to write a letter, which they then refused to acknowledge, and again actually sent out like a legal letter of disagreeing with the reason, with our interpretation of the law. It was just I was really upset by it. We had to get the school lawyer to say no, this is the law, whatever, and they backed off, but begrudgingly and with a chip on their shoulders, thinking that we're usurping their
employees that are under your problem.
Yeah, but a lot of it was brought forward by their attempts to look at our policy manual because of the nomenclature, the lettering and the way that the chapter headings, it is difficult to sort through it sometimes because different thing related things aren't always together and all that, and they had a hard time even understanding the way it worked.
Did they go to the MASC? They never received it. The only thing that was disappointing on that, and you're making it a lot more harsh than I took it. I was just kind of like, you know, there's a school committee that oversees the policy of the school and its personnel, and that's the whole reason it's been put together.
Right.
And that was kind of us kind of just saying, that's what the law is. And their kind of pushback was that they're concerned about liability in human resources issues in the town. And I said, yeah, you know, I mean, that's the truth. I mean, if the school gets sued, the school committee will get sued, okay, for a policy.
Forgot to tell you that part to these.
Yeah, that's what happens. The school committee will get sued. The school committee is the governing body for the town. So the town is actually being sued, you know what I mean? So it's kind of like some of people kind of forget that. It's kind of like I'm an employee of Conway. And that's another thing people have to remember. I'm not just kind of this third-party person. You pay my salary. I'm the CEO of your It's just one of those, but yeah. I mean, if they look online, it's a lot easier to look at the policies online than it used to be with the big book. You can just kind of, you can type in words that you're looking for, and it'll bring up every single. You write homeless, it'll tell you every single policy we have on homeless.
Cool.
You know what I mean? You type in whatever you're looking for. So
but they do have a big checklist for us to work through at some point.
Okay.
Well, they can, you know, you can send it to me and I can tell them where, what we got and what we don't have.
Alrighty, Kristen.
So, just real quickly.
It's very concise tonight.
Yes. Our NDWEA results were great. 75% of our students grade 3 to 6 are on target with reading, 71%. And math, we know the students who aren't, and what we have certainly plans for each one of those, but those are great numbers. We're thrilled. Our global play day on February 5th was a huge success. So the children literally played all day long. We didn't give them anything to play with. Staff was told don't interject, don't interfere. Some teachers were very nervous about this day.
Where are the flies?
Well, I was like, we have nothing to play with. They're like,
some kids brought blankets. They were making forts.
They had stuff.
Yeah, but we didn't give them like, okay, here's some, you know, Legos or anything like that.
Mm. I started getting texts from parents. Is your daughter bringing anything?
Oh, yeah. They were allowed to bring. You know, first grade was just a beautiful moment. They were playing. There were six kids playing school, and one was the teacher, and they were sounding out their syllables together, just like Miss Wheeler does in first grade. She had her little students all set up, and you know, so it was a. They played all day long. Rick Gifford had a Monopoly game starting at 8:45 that went till 2:30. He was playing with the kids.
Hope he didn't win.
He didn't. But what teachers said was that they were able to do some great observations of kids in a different way and who they played with and who came out as sort of some natural leaders. Yeah. And the kids said it was the best day of their lives. Yeah, could you give the survey to the kids now about me? That would be great. Best principal in the world.
I want to see that classroom set up with the mean principal.
So that was amazing.
That's cool.
Yeah.
We do have to thank Kristen for these lovely. I mean, there's raisins in case.
I saw. How thoughtful.
In case you missed a meal today.
I'm not touching those, but.
Yeah.
We have a STEAM club that Kate Arsenault is doing on Tuesdays and Thursdays. High attendance for that. And our Nature's Classroom is going to be going. We changed the week. So since I've been here, it's been like the first week of September,
so
which I'm always like, oh my God, you don't even know the kids.
Right.
Yeah.
It's Maggie West, the teacher, going, is so excited. She knows the kids. They've built relationships. They've done a few sleepovers already. Yeah. They usually come into fifth grade not doing a sleepover.
Yeah.
So they're geared up and ready to go and very excited to go. So thanks for supporting that trip.
Can
we
you
love
have
it.
For the record?
I cannot be a guest reader this year, but
guest reader.
I highly recommend it.
Phil.
It's really fun.
Oh, yeah.
You did it last year, Phil.
You can even read in your...
Oh, I loved it.
You can do it,
that was
Phil?
A blast. Yeah.
Can read in
we
your kids' class.
You. You're in, Phil?
Yep.
Yeah, let me write down.
March 2nd, 9 to 10.
Yeah, definitely. I loved it.
It's fun.
I love that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good time.
It's just one day.
It's just
one
hour.
Yeah, it's 9 to 10. Be great. Let me
just
know.
One book.
Just one book. Dr. Seuss book.
And you can choose a book. You can
Red
choose
fish,
the book, too, if so there's any outside your range.
Books.
You can choose a book. Yeah.
Maddie will be like, no, it's so embarrassing.
Yeah.
Don't come in.
Talk about embarrassing. So when I did it, I read a book called Underwear.
That's great.
It was so much fun.
That's great. Did Maddie like the Global Play Day?
Oh, yeah.
She did. It was great. Yeah. It was a really great day. We were nervous. I was nervous, you know, unstructured. It was great. Mm-hmm. They use their imaginations, you know. Really fun.
Do you have a report, sir?
I do not.
Okay. I have a report not quite as uplifting, but I wanted you to know about it. Kristen, I don't know. So there was a successful suicide of a high schooler in Northampton a couple weeks ago. And
successful suicide, that's a term?
That is a term.
Man, what a horrible term.
Versus attempted, yeah. And that, but I mean, just as running mental health clinics in the area, there's been a ton of very serious attempts. So my agency is putting on a suicide prevention training geared towards school counselors. So, and it's only like a 3-hour commitment. I brought you a flyer.
Oh, super. Thank you.
So, this guy is world-renowned on suicide prevention, and it's going to be at Holyoke High School. Great. All the districts we're in are, you know, supporting. So, Chicopee, Holyoke. We have room for up to 500, so I think there's probably plenty of room for you guys.
Great.
It's absolutely an epidemic. It's just awful.
But I recommended him when, so my person that coordinates our school contracts said to me after this happened, just said, you know, like, there seems to be a huge uptick in serious attempts. And what can we do? And so I thought of this professional who I saw years ago, and usually I'm kind of a bad conference goer. Like, I go and I'm like, tell me something. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I've been doing this a long time. But he is very impressive. He's very organized. He's up on all the latest research. And I think they'll all get something out of it, because you don't, no matter when you've been to school, you don't get enough training in that.
Correct.
And so I think it's a very, so it's from 4 to 7.
Great.
We offer CEUs for people that need them for mental health licensing. I don't know about what you guys need, and for if you need continuing education things, but certainly we could come up with something.
I mean, someone might need PDPs, especially counseling.
Yeah. But I just thought I'd bring it to your attention, because
Thank you.
Worth, and it's free. We're asking the bigger districts to make a donation toward the cost of the speaker, but you guys are small enough, you don't have to worry about it.
If you don't fill to 500 with school employees, will it be opened up to the bigger community?
I'm sure, yeah. I mean, we can, we'll see. I'll let you know, but I'm sure we'll have some space, because not everybody's going to give up that little time span, but it's so important. I mean, after the one at Northampton, I went and talked to my kids and was like, so if you had a friend, you know, and, you know, that you were concerned about and was saying things or whatever, what would you do? You know, and one of my kids was like, well, I would immediately tell an adult, a teacher. And I'm like, exactly. And the other kid said, well, if they want me to. And I'm like, wrong. I said, doesn't matter if they want you to or not. I said, this is a time where you don't keep a person's confidence, because you have to think of the worst case scenario if you didn't say anything and something bad happened. So that is the time you speak up. And people don't talk about their kids about that kind of stuff. And I think you have to, because they do, especially with the phones and kids saying, you know, one, you could say it's a dramatic thing the kid's saying, but if you have a sense it's different or off the hook, you should say something, you know, because those are the kind of things that we can do to help prevent it. And sometimes the kids certainly know before we know.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And better than we know. I don't know if you were in the district when the kid killed his mother and killed himself a couple of years ago in Chicopee. He was 15 years old, you know, and was in school and was sent home and, you know, awful, awful, awful things. So,
and just from my understanding, knowledge of the families involved, like almost all of the opioid overdose deaths in our immediate, like, district, in the towns that comprise our district, involved significant elements of suicidal ideology and whatever, all that stuff, and especially that initial decision to try opioids, like, and where that intersects with suicidal thought and all that is just.
But it's all, I mean, there's so, I mean, it's so sad now, the things you can research, and there's so many things in a household.
It's not even research, it's social media too.
Right.
I mean, there is so many ways for kids to access.
Right.
And, like, dares and packs, and it's really scary as a parent.
And so much of that stuff is just available in a household or in anywhere. It's just, you know, and my medical director says all the time, you know, you can, 1 minute be sitting with the kid, and they're actually, they are fine. They are stable, but that's all the nature of adolescence is that it's so turbulent and so, like, you know, you can be fine 1 minute and not the next. It only takes a second to make a really bad decision, yeah. You know.
And I think that's present in adults as well.
Absolutely.
You know, they might give that perception of they're perfectly fine and right. Actually not.
Absolutely.
Right. It's really difficult.
So
avoid permanent solutions to temporary problems.
Absolutely. So anyway, so if you want to send your staff,
thank you.
Please feel free.
Can you send it to me digitally? I could also scan it too. But
no, I can send it to you digitally. Anything else? Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Great budget.